for the future. When Rudolph Bing began his work as general manager of the Met in 1950, his decision to hire African-American singers would forever change the face of opera in America and indeed in the world. He was a very complex man, a man of great talent and also of great contradictions. He walked and talked softly, but he carried a very big stick. And the descriptions of him, and often in his own words of self-description, highlight the complexities of his character. Because the primary interest for my research has been singers, in the past, Bing was always sort of a supporting character or in the supporting narrative for me. But I decided that I was interested in exploring him more, and that thus this paper came forward. Some of the information about Bing and his background is readily available. Yet, in some way, he remains a mystery to us. I've been intrigued by the things that we don't know so much about him, primarily what were his influences. I'm interested in determining why he made the decisions he made. And with that in mind, I've started to look backwards a bit, to look at why we remember him. Bing is remembered, I think, in the US and in Europe for different reasons. The first reason, I think, is probably similar on both continents. He was a man of great business acumen. In the US, secondly, as was mentioned earlier, he's remembered for integrating the Met in 1955 as the first singer. And then thirdly, the move to Lincoln Center, which was a very big deal. And I focus primarily here on the integration of the Met regarding the singers. In terms of what we know about him, he was born into a family of wealth. His father was a wealthy industrialist. He grew up in great privilege. He had governesses throughout his childhood, and they spoke English, and they only spoke English to the children. And so he determines that that is why he had such ease with the language as he grew up and moved around the world and dealt with people of backgrounds of English. At the end of the war, of course, working in the family business was not an option, and neither was going to the university. So he had several odd jobs, which led him to a career in concert and artist management. And I think this is the period where he really developed his character and his work ethos and ethic became more apparent. Very early on, he demonstrated that he was not interested in avoiding offending people, either personally or politically. He said exactly what was on his mind. He insisted on doing things his way and was not easily influenced. He was not swayed by emotional eruptions of singers particularly, and he took every opportunity to demonstrate his intolerance of singers' tirades. This is a photograph of Faust, and it includes two of my favorite singers. On the left is Jussi Björling, and second to the right is Robert Merrill. Bing's decision to cast Leontine Price and Justino Diaz in the title roles of Antony and Cleopatra in 1966 in Barber's opera was a very big deal. Casting Price to open the new house at the height of the civil rights movement, I think it's hard for us to imagine how big this was socially and politically in the US. It established his position on the issue of race, although he had talked about it previously. His position basically was if you could sing, he didn't care if you were purple. And certainly Leontine Price could sing. In 1951, connecting to the dance history that's been laid out for us, he hired Janet Collins to dance the lead dance role in Aida. She stayed on to dance in four other productions, and she was there for 2 years. And in 1954, being hired Sylvia Olden Lee as an accompanist in the training program. Sylvia Lee's mother had been a singer and had, actually they met at Fisk University and were introduced by Cravath. Sylvia's parents, excuse me, were introduced by Cravath at Fisk. It's important to understand Bing's actions and the social context, the social and political context of what he did. Jim Crow laws and racial segregation were both the law and the practice, as has been mentioned previously, of the major part of the country. There were constant reminders for blacks to stay in their place, and also reminders for whites to support and uphold maintaining the status quo. Of course, there was resistance, and civil disobedience started primarily on a small scale, but moved very quickly. And eventually, it landed in the judicial system as a remedy. And I've highlighted a few of those cases within the judicial system. Progress was made over a long period of time, but it certainly was not without a long, hard fight. There was pushback, and the pushback was fierce, and it was strategic. When I first saw this photograph, I actually was shocked by it, and I've been researching in this area for a long time, not just in race and opera, but in race and segregation and civil rights in general in America. And this was shocking to me. And as I thought more about it and considered the history not only of race in America, but the race in Europe, the reality is that much has been claimed in the name of religion throughout histories of civilization that I'm not so sure that the founders of those religions would support. But a great deal has been used, particularly in the 40s, 50s, around the issues of race and connections with churches in America. The resistance to segregation, to integration, was met with a full assault and by decades of violence and against the protesters. And of course, there was resistance from the public related to integrating the Met. It was not necessarily resistance to Anderson, but more to the fact that a black would be singing at the Met. In Bing's words, he simply ignored it, which is blatantly not true. He responded to every nasty letter, every nasty comment, every divisive thing that was uttered within earshot, whether it was in the media or personally. I can't imagine how he could convince himself that he ignored any of it. His choice of Marian Anderson was a great one. She was an international star of the concert stage, but she was not an opera singer. She did not know any operatic roles and had practically ceased singing operatic arias in her concerts by the mid-1950s. Early in her career, she sang a great deal of operatic arias in her concerts, and she also had a penchant for changing the keys. So although she was a contralto and could sing mezzo literature, if she liked an aria, she would just simply change the key, even if it was clearly an operatic aria written for a lyric soprano. Even for her, there were first steps. Having no stage experience in opera, she had to rehearse intensively. I think far more than would be expected for a role the size. But some of the greatest photographs, I think, come from this period, and the one on the left is one of my absolute favorites of her, with hands outstretched. I see it as actually a quite triumphant pose, but has as much to do with, I think, the social statement of her being there as with what's happening in the opera at the time. Despite Anderson's age, it was a good choice. She was beyond her vocal prime, but most people ignore that and sort of dismiss the critics, those who dared say something about her singing at the time. It was a unique and extraordinary voice, and she accomplished a great deal of firsts in her long career. However, many of the firsts that were attributed to her were done so inaccurately. I can't count the times that I have seen in reputable publications that she was the first African American singer to perform at the White House, and it absolutely is not true. She did sing there a couple of times during the Franklin Roosevelt administration, but she was not the first. To understand the significance of her achievements, it's important, I think, to view them within historical and social context. The photo here is of Marie Celica Williams, who is the second on the list. As could be expected for a lot of singers born during that time, the age of birth was often controversial and in question. The first person on the list is Elizabeth Greenfield, who many attribute her birth date as 1809. However, I've seen birth dates up to 1825 and 1827. So, but I've seen the preponderance early in the century, so I list it as 1809. Harry Burley is a person we associate primarily with concert literature. Any of you who are particularly familiar with concert versions of Negro spirituals, most of them that you will have heard were arranged by Burley. And there is a great great biography that just came out a couple of years ago about Burley. I feel actually good about the time that I've been researching this topic, because in talking to Jean Snyder, who authored the book on Burley, she had been researching for over 20 years before she published it. I'll skip through the list, but I think there will be some names that you recognize. Roland Hayes. I'll jump back to the top. Sidney Woodward was a tenor. And are there some Americans here other than the presenters here? Okay, so there's an American television show in the 50s, 60s called Bonanza. And there is an episode of Bonanza about a Negro performer who goes through this town, and he is a concert singer. And they actually use the name Sidney Woodward, but in the television show, he's a baritone. In reality, tenors never get a break, but in reality, he was a tenor. And I highlight Marian Anderson's name on here just to show you that she was not the first to do this. There was a long line of people. The last person on the list was mentioned in the previous presentation, Katharina Yarborough. There also is a controversy about Jules Bledsoe's birth date, but it's not quite as wide as Elizabeth Greenfield's. Lillian Evante debuted in Nice in 1925, singing the title role of Lakme. And Yarborough sang, as mentioned earlier, in Aida in 1930 in Nice. Anderson did break barriers, and she challenged the status quo, but she was not the first. Elizabeth Taylor Greenfield, who was the first on the list, was dubbed the Black Swan. She was considered the best African-American concert singer at her time. She was born in slavery, but was adopted by a Quaker family in Philadelphia, and moved and was educated by the Friends of Society. Her debut was 1851. In 1853, she traveled to London and performed for Queen Victoria, and actually had some singing lessons from the Queen's organist at the time. Cicireta Jones was one of the first to sing at the White House. Actually, Marie Celica Williams was the first. Jones sang during the Benjamin Harrison era, and she was called the Black Patty in a reference to the celebrated Italian opera Adelina Patti. She performed stage scenes in costume, also on the vaudeville stage, but she never sang vaudeville music. She also always sang operatic music. Unfortunately, she died before fulfilling her dream of singing in a major opera house. I list here just a few of the first African-Americans to sing at the Met. First, of course, was Marian Anderson in 55, Robert McFerrin in 55 also, Mattie Wilder Dobbs in 56, and another first, to George Shirley, who was the first tenor, African-American to sing at the Met. Robert McFerrin debuted approximately 2 weeks after Anderson. However, because of the enormous historic significance of Anderson's debut, his debut was overshadowed, I should say. Anderson did not have a continuing contract. She was contracted to sing a specific number of performances. However, Robert McFerrin's contract was a continuing contract. He sang three roles, and he was the first African American to sing a title role at the Met. He sang the role of Rigoletto. Some of you may be familiar with his namesake, his son, who was Bobby McFerrin. Next was Mattie Wilder Dobbs. She was the second to sing a title role at the Met. She sang Lucia. And Mattie Wilder Dobbs told me in a very candid conversation one evening over dinner that when Bing asked her if she knew Lucia and had sung Lucia, she said, without taking a breath, yes, of course. She said she neither knew it and certainly has not sung it. So she raced home and learned the opera, and he actually cast her in Lucia thinking that she had performed it. But he never bothered to check where. Because he had, of course, he was familiar with her singing. She began singing in Europe in opera houses. But as Carolyn mentioned, Bing did not hire anyone who was not already a seasoned performer. And he would not have risked Lucia being Mattie Wilder's first performance at the Met. She was the first African-American singer to have a truly international career as an opera singer. She wasn't the first to have an international career, but as an opera singer, she was. She sang in major opera houses throughout Europe and other parts of the world. She sang six roles while there. And one of the roles I think that she's most noted for around the world was Zerbinetta, which is a very, very difficult role for coloratura sopranos. Interestingly, the same year that Marian Anderson was making her debut at the Met, Mattie Wilder made her debut at San Francisco Opera. George Shirley was the first African-American tenor to sing at the Met and the first to sing a romantic role there. He had a very long and successful career at the Met. He made his debut in Così fan tutti, singing Ferrando, and it is a role that he went on to win a Grammy for. He sang a wide variety of roles at the Met. He sang mostly leading roles or featured roles. He, however, eventually was taxed vocally because he had a phenomenal memory, he had perfect pitch, and he could be called on at a moment's notice to sing almost anything. And he did, because he felt he had to do that. And so he sang roles that eventually he learned he should not have sung, but he had a very long and distinguished career. Matty Wilde's passing, I think, marked the end of an era. It was an era, first, where the concert singers had the greatest notoriety, and then the Met integrated, and there were lots of names who came along because of that. Many of those singers moved on to have careers in Europe after singing at the Met. And some of those were mentioned, Lillian Evante, whose name, birth name was Lillian Tibbs. Lillian Evans Tibbs was her name. Katerina Yarborough and Mary Wilde Dobbs. Rudolph Bing was certainly a man of the times, and as Matty Wilde's death marked the end of an era, I believe Bing's death marked the passing of an era. His work and his success at the Met landed him on the cover of both Time magazine and Newsweek in September 66 for the opening of the Met, and again on Time magazine later in his career. The mark that he made on opera in the US and on the global opera scene was indelible. He is remembered for his accomplishments as well as his personal characteristics. And among those, I think, which should be celebrated the most is courage. Thank you very much.